Exactly. It created more wealth over time than any other company. Western Union passed on it. A few years later, they were brought the patents for the radio. They were asked if they wanted to invest in it. No, don't need the radio. We think we're doing fine with telegraph. A little bit later, it was television. They were brought all the patents. They passed on every one of them, including the internet and including cell phones.
Yeah.
And as a result, this company, it existed, but their business today is exactly the same as their business 130 years ago, sending money orders from one place to another. It's teetered on the verge of bankruptcy. It's been bought and sold. It's been rehabilitated, but it's never changed its model. How insular.
Yeah. Now, you do talk about automobile, and you do mention Toyota.
Yeah.
Which suddenly, this year, has not had a glowing report.
Well, you know, Toyota was a common purpose company. They were my first client when I worked with them 25 years ago. They were a very strong, very quality-oriented company. And over time, they changed. They became more and more of a company oriented toward finances, and quality, still important, was not the main issue that that they faced. So, but the problem is, it happened over a very long period of time, and they didn't even notice it.
Yeah.
So they thought that they were a common purpose company, and they became a finance company. In fact, in Japan, they joke and they call Toyota the Bank of Toyota because it's so financially driven.
Interesting about CEOs. Many years ago, I interviewed Andrew Grove, and he had written a book, and it talked about his business and management. And he said, I sit and once a month or once every couple of months, I have a group who will tell me what I'm doing wrong. Well, I have to say, I was brought up where nobody criticizes the president. And I said, oh, come on. It's true. He allowed it, and that's why Intel grew.
Well, and very much so. And Intel had a sense of mission. You know, Connie, one of the things that strikes me as really important toward the development of a great company, not just a good, not just a profitable company, but a great company, is that the leaders in those companies impart on the people who work there the idea that they're there to change the world. Not just to make money, but to change the world. Andy Grove at Intel in those days, they were changing the world. Bill Gates in the early days at Microsoft, changing the world.
But you said that Microsoft played too tough.
Yeah, Microsoft was very insular, and it adopted a kind of us versus them mentality.
Mm-hmm.
They had the feeling that they were actually a weak and vulnerable company. And so they attacked their rivals as if they were enemies, as if this were war and not business. And what happened is the backlash against them was very, very strong. Now, you can attack a company, but if you attack every company, sooner or later the powers that are arrayed against you are just too big and powerful for any company. And Microsoft was almost on the verge of being broken up by the government.
You have also been directing the world, global group that meets in Davos for seminars there. When you have people, say, from a Microsoft with Apple or something, how do they handle each other? How do leaders interface?
You know, it's interesting. The leaders who are secure, who are trying to accomplish a mission and not just aggrandize their egos, are very comfortable with each other. In fact, they have a lot of respect for each other. So you can see Bill Gates and a Steve Jobs, who have tremendous respect for each other and what each of them has achieved. It's the lesser leaders, the B leaders, who are trying to insulate and who are insecure, who are trying to build the company as a statue to themselves, who don't get along with each other.
And yet, I love that where you said about leaders, that the underlings have a tendency to imitate them.
Yeah.
And that with Bill Gates, everybody started rocking on their feet and doing all of his gestures. Same way there was the leader who was not named, who was a womanizer and a drinker and probably was still very successful. I can think of one or two whose names trippingly come off Kiplinger, but we won't say them.
Yeah.
But they are also a form of leadership that can be destructive to families connected with it.
Well, you know, what people don't realize is that in a way we're wired to be leaders and, for lack of a better word, followers. People are wired that way. We have neurons inside our brains called mirror neurons that essentially have us copying the behaviors, even the gestures, even the mannerisms of other people. And so a leader really has to understand that when they walk through the hall, when they raise their voice at someone because they're angry, that these behaviors are transmitted through the whole organization and people assume they can do them also.
Yeah.
So when we have a company, like some of the Wall Street firms, where you have a leader who's very greedy, very egocentric, who's built a moat around himself and doesn't interact with others, that's how the whole organization becomes structured, because people copy the behaviors and of the leaders.